فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So the author رحمه الله brought the authentic story of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman رضي الله تعالى عنهما. Hudhayfa, he said, صليت مع النبي, I prayed with the Prophet. ذات ليلة والنايت. فافتتح البقرة. And then he opened up with Surah Al-Baqarah. فَقُلْتُ I said to myself, يَرَكَعُ عِنْدَ الْمِعَةِ When the Prophet ﷺ reaches 100 verses, he's going to do ruku'. ثُمَّ مَضَى And then he carried on, the messenger. فَقُلْتُ Then I said to myself, يُصَلِّي بِهَا فِي رَكْعَةٍ He's going to pray with it in one rak'ah, Surah Al-Baqarah. ثُمَّ مَضَى He carried on. فَقُلْتُ I said to myself, يركع بها he carried on and I said to myself he's going to do ركوع here
ثم تفتح النساء سورة النساء then he opened with سورة النساء so sorry that when he finished سورة البقرة I said okay he's going to complete سورة البقرة and we're now going to go to ركوع no but ثم افتتح النساء he opened with سورة النساء فقرأها he read it all of it ثم افتتح آل عمران and then he opened آل عمران فقرأها he read it يقرأ مترسلا he was reading it calmly and collectively إذا مر بآية فيها تسبيح سبح if there was a verse in which he wanted to exalt Allah he exalted him and he said سبحان الله وإذا مر بآية سؤال if he became a verse of question سأل he asked وإذا أمر وإذا مر and if he came across a verse تعوض he seek refuge in Allah from it سبحانه وتعالى رواه مسلم الإمام مسلم narrated it and then الإمام النووي رحمه الله said something which is سورة النساء في ذلك الوقت at that time مقدمة على آل عمران it was before آل عمران so سورة النساء used to be before آل عمران it used to be before it Yeah. That's the argument that they use. They say to show you that the order has been changed. The fact that the Prophet changed the order. Are you there? ولذلك there's a qira'ah from the qira'at. I think qira'ah Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Surah An-Nisa was still to him before Surah Al Imran. And so they said, since there are difference between the two, that's an indication and an evidence to say what? That you are allowed to. That it's permissible for you to read, for example, a surah and then go up again. That you can do that. Na'am. But not with the ayat. You can't go verses backwards. The author then said after that,
Shafi'i scholars have stated that such supplication, seeking refuge and glorification are recommended for all reciters, whether they are reciting during prayers or not. They also say that such acts are recommended in prayers for the imam, those being led in the prayer, and one who is praying alone, as this is a form of supplication, and so all those involved are equal with regard to practicing it. Just as they are equal with regards to saying
Ameen
after
Al-Fatiha. So the Shafi'iyah believe that it's recommended to ask and to seek refuge in Allah and to exalt Him. This is for every reciter. Whether that reciter is in the prayer or whether he's not praying. Whether he's the leader and he's leading the salah or whether he's the one who's been led. Whether he's praying alone or whether he's praying in a jama'ah. They said that this is a dua and everybody is the same in it. It's like the Ameen. Everybody is in there. Naam.
What we have mentioned regarding supplication being recommended at all times is the ruling according to the Shafi'i school of thought and the vast majority of scholars. Abu Hanifa, on the other hand, holds that such...
This matter of... That it's recommended to ask and to seek refuge in Allah is something Nawawi expands highly on in his sharah of Al-Muhadhab li Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi al-Majmu'. He expands on it highly, the fourth volume, if you go to it, page 75. He expands on it highly. And he attributes this to the view of the what? Jamahir al-ulama. Jamahir means what? The majority. The majority of the scholars also hold this opinion. وَقَالَ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ النُّعْمَانِ بْنُ بَشِيرِ ابْنُ ثَابِتَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ أَمَا رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ. He said, لَا يُسْتَحَبُّ ذَلِكَ. It's not recommended. بَلْ يُكْرَهُ فِي الصَّلَاةِ. Rather, it is disliked in the prayer. And if you want to know more about that, الْمَرْغِينَانِ. Al-Marghinani, who's got a kitab called Al-Hidayah, first volume, page 143, he also expands on it as well, according to what is the strongest view of the Hanafis. He expands on it and he speaks about it there. He clearly says, وَيَسْتَمِعُ, he should listen, وَيَنْصُتُ, وَيَنْصِتُ, and he should be quiet, وَإِنْ قَرَعَ الْإِمَامُ آيَةَ التَّرْغِيبُ وَالتَّرْهِيبُ. Marghinani says, this kitab al-Marghinani wrote, al-kitab al-Hidayah, is a kitab that the Ahnaf have really praised it to another level. It's profound to them, it's an amazing kitab. To the extent that this kitab has over 70 shuruh and explanation and hawashi that has been put on it. It's from the books that the Ahnaf, kitab al-Hidayah. And it's the kitab that al-Zayla'i, the great Somali scholar, he had done takhrij on that kitab and he called it Nasb al-Raya fi takhrij kitabi al-Hidayah, kitab al-Marghinani. The word, the place Zayla'i, his name Zayla'i, Zayla'i is in Somalia. Somalia. No. والصواب قول الجماهير. He says that the strongest opinion is the view of the majority of the scholars, لما قدمناه, as we have mentioned, because of the fact that they have a hadith. في التنبيه على احترام القرآن من بعض ما يتساهل به بعض الغافلين ومما يعتنى به ويتأكد الأمر به احترام القرآن من أمور قد يتساهل فيها بعض الغافلين القارئين مجتمعين فمن ذلك اجتناب الضحك والغلط والغلط. You can say both ways. والحديث في حال القراءة إلا كلام يضطر إليه وليمتثل أمر الله سبحانه وتعالى وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون وليقتدي بما رواه ابن أبي داود عن ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما أنه كان إذا قرأ القرآن لا يتكلم حتى يفرغ مما أراد أن يقرأ ورواه البخاري في صحيحه وقال لم يتكلم حتى يفرغ منه ذكره في كتاب التفسير في قول الله تعالى نساؤكم حرث لكم ومن ذلك العبث باليد وغيرها فإنه يناجي ربه سبحانه وتعالى فلا يعبث بين يديه ومن ذلك النظر إلى ما يلهي ويبدد الذهن وأقبح من هذا كله النظر إلى ما لا يجوز النظر إليه كالأمرد وغيره فإن النظر إلى الأمرد الحسن من غير حاجة حرام سواء كان بشهوة أو بغيرها سواء أمن الفتنة أو لم يأمنها هذا هو المذهب الصحيح المختار عند العلماء وقد نص على تحريمه الإمام الشافعي ومن لا يحصى من العلماء ودليله قول الله تعالى قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم الآية ولأنه في معنى المرأة بل ربما كان بعضهم أو كثير منهم أحسن من كثير من النساء ويتمكن من أسباب الريبة فيه ويتسهل من طرق الشر في حق ما لا يتسهل في حق المرأة فكان تحريم أولى وقاوير السلف في التنفير منهم أكثر من أن تحصر وقد سموهم الأنتان لكونهم مستقذرين شرعا وأما النظر إليه في حال البيع والشراء والأخذ والعطاء والتطبيب والتعليم ونحوها من مواضع الحاجة فجائز للضرورة لكن يقتصر الناظر على قدر الحاجة ولا يديم النظر من غير ضرورة وكذا المعلم إنما يباح له النظر الذي يحتاج إليه ويحرم عليهم كلهم في كل الأحوال النظر بشهوة ولا يختص هذا بالأمرد بل يحرم على كل مكلف النظر بالشهوة إلى كل أحد رجلا كان أو امرأة محرما كانت المرأة أو غيرها إلا الزوجة والمملوكة التي يملك الاستمتاع بها حتى قال أصحابنا يحرم النظر بالشهوة إلى محارمه كبنته وأمه والله أعلم وعلى الحاضرين مجلس القراءة إذا رأوا شيئا من هذه المنكرات المذكورة وغيرها أن ينهوا عنه على حسب الإمكان باليد لمن قدر وباللسان لمن عجز you can say لمن عجز عن اليد وقدر على اللسان وإلا فلينكر بقلبه والله أعلم The author now is going to go into a mas'ala I personally don't feel comfortable talking about and I remember my sheikh when he taught us this kitab He jumped this chapter. And he didn't teach it. But the point is, the khulasa is, he talks about looking at that which is haram from you. That it's not permissible whilst you're reading the Quran. The things that the person should avoid is looking at things that are haram from you. And he goes into more details, but it's not necessary for us to go through it. You just need to know, you need to lower your gaze and not look at it. But the first part of the discussion, we will read it inshallah ta'ala. And then we'll jump to the next chapter.
Section. Among that which must be paid attention to and strictly adhered to is the honouring of the Qur'an against some of that which negligent reciters are unknown to do.
So some people, honouring the Qur'an, من أمور قد يتساءل فيها بعض الغافلين القارئين مجتمعين. There are some matters when it comes to honoring the Qur'an that some people show leniency towards. And they're heedless about it when they're reading the Qur'an. And he mentions those things. فَمِنْ ذَلِكَ From those matters are?
Such as laughing, chattering, and talking throughout a recitation without necessity.
So, اجتناب الضحك والغلطي. Qur'an recitation is going on and people are So somebody's reciting in the masjid and other people are here talking, chatting and laughing. Or he himself is actually reading and while he's reading, in the middle of it he's chatting and he's laughing. And there's no real need for it. Because he says, إِلَّا كَلَامًا يُطَرُّ إِلَيْهِ If the speech is necessary, you have to mention something to somebody, then this is permissible. The word al-ghald, it means اختلاف الأصوات, اختلاط الأصوات. When two people are talking and their voices start mixing, meaning it's back and fourth discussion.
The reciter should instead obey Allah's order stated in Surah Al-A'raf. And if the Quran is recited, then listen to it and pay attention to it, so that you may perhaps receive the mercy of Allah.
Here the author talks about the issue of listening to the Quran when it's being recited and not talking. And that's why he says, وَلِيَمْتَثِلْ That the person should follow the command of Allah, which is وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ وَإِذَا أَرَادَ قِرَاءَةَ الْقُرْآنِ if he wants to recite the Qur'an, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ when the Qur'an is being recited, عِنْدَ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ listen to it, وَأَنصِتْ and be quiet. So some scholars, they took from this, فَاسْتَمِعُوا listen, here means that you yourself can't read with them. وَأَنْصِتُ and be quiet. So the silence here, even if you are not saying worldly things, but you just want to read the Qur'an with them, it's not permissible. That's what some scholars took from that. But the istithna here is that if you're trying to memorize with them, or you're trying to learn, then you're allowed to do so, but not on normally. Naam.
The reciter should strive to do that which Ibn Abu Dawood narrated of the woman, namely, that he would not talk at all until he had completed that which he had intended to recite. This is narrated in Al-Bukhari, and he deemed this to be sahih with a slightly different wording. He mentioned it in the book of Tafsir under the section dealing with Allah's verse, "Your wives are tilth for you."
Here, أنه كان إذا قرأ القرآن, that if he read the Quran, Ibn Umar, لا يتكلم, he will never speak, حتى يفرغ مما أراد أن يقرأ, until he finished what he intended to read, he wouldn't. نعم.
The reciter should avoid fidgeting with his hands and other similar actions as he is talking to his Lord, and should therefore not be frolicking around before him.
So the person should not play with their hands whilst reading the Quran, picking up twigs, playing with the masjid carpet. Shouldn't do that. The reason is because فَإِنَّهُ يُنَاجِي رَبَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. You're talking and you're discussing with your Lord. فَلَا يَعْبُثْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. In front of your Lord, don't play around. Don't play around. We'll go to the next chapter now. فَصْلٌ فِي حُكْمِ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ بِغَيْرِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ. لا تجوز قراءة القرآن بالعجمية سواء أحسن العربية أم لم يحسنها سواء كان في الصلاة أم في غيرها فإن قرأ بها في الصلاة لم تصح صلاته. هذا مذهبنا ومذهب مالك وأحمد وداود وأبي بكر بن المنذر. وقال أبو حنيفة رحمه الله يجوز ذلك وتصح به الصلاة. وقال أبو يوسف ومحمد يجوز ذلك لمن يحسن العربية ولا يجوز لمن يحسنها.
Section. It is not permissible to recite the Quran in a foreign language.
So no one is allowed to read Quran in English. Now, does the transliteration fall under this? The transliteration that we have today, I personally say it will fall under this, because the transliteration, it doesn't have the Arabic language in it, especially the makharij. And a lot of the people who actually read incorrectly the Quran, if you investigate a lot of them, it came because they tried to look at the transliteration and they took mistakes that are severe, that can change the whole prayer. Huh? The brother is saying to Aki, 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 where did he get that from? KH. That's where it came from, right? Because in English it's written like that. It's A, KH, right? I. So he reads it in English, so he says Aki, okay. But what he doesn't know is that the word is not in Arabic language, it's in Dutch. 88, they say Achtan Tachtach. That's 88 for them. Yeah, so they got kha. Dutch people, they have kha. English don't have it. Do they have it? Even when they say like they're fighting, sah. Yeah, sah. So the kha is not in the English language at all. So how are you going to tell this person that this word is kha? He would have to go back to the Arabic language, and you have to teach him that there's a makhraj called kha. So na'am, في حكم قراءة القرآن بغير العربية, the transliteration will fall into this. Very dangerous. Okay? Na'am.
Whether the reciter knows Arabic or not.
لا تجوز قراءة القرآن بالعجمية. It is not permissible to read the Quran in another language. سواء أحسن العربية. Whether that person can perfect the language or he can't, it's not permissible.
And whether he recites it in his prayers or outside of that.
So it's not allowed in the prayer and it's not allowed outside the prayer.
If he does recite the Quran in a foreign language while praying, his prayers become invalidated.
Naam.
This is the ruling according to our school of thought, Shafi'i.
So this is the madhab, Malik, Abu Ahmed, Abu Dawood, Abu Bakr ibn Mundir, rahimahumullahu jami'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow His never ending mercy onto them all. They all believe that. So it's a Shafi'i. هذا مذهبنا. This is our madhab, meaning يعني madhab Shafi'iyah. ومذهب مالك يعني إمام مالك مذهب وأحمد وداود وأبي بكر بن المنذر نعم
Abu Hanifa, however, rules that it is permissible and that the reciter's prayer is valid. Abu Yusuf and Muhammad, who are both Hanafi scholars, rules that this is permissible.
Here, Muhammad is Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. The Muhammad here, Abu Yusuf and Muhammad, the Muhammad here is Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. They were both Hanafis. Ma'adhalika, they went against Abu Hanifa. What did they say?
They ruled that this is permissible for one who is unable to recite in Arabic, but impermissible otherwise.
So they done tafsil. Whereas Abu Hanifa rahimahullah unrestrictedly said, يَجُوزُ ذَلِكَ it is permissible, وَتَصِحُ بِهِ صَلَاةً He said it's permissible. فصل في حكم قراءة القرآن بالقراءات المتواترة والشاذة وتجوز قراءة القرآن بالقراءات السبع المجمع عليها ولا تجوز بغير السبع ولا بالروايات الشاذة المنقولة عن القراء السبعة وسيأتي في الباب السابع إن شاء الله تعالى بيان اتفاق الفقهاء على استتابة من قرأ بالشاذ أو قرأ بها قال أصحابنا وغيرهم لو قرأ بالشواذ في الصلاة بطلت صلاته إن كان عالما وإن كان جاهلا لم تبطل ولا تحسب له تلك القراءة وقد نقل الإمام أبو عمر بن عبد البر الحافظ بإجماع المسلمين أبو عمر بن عبد البر الحافظ إجماع المسلمين على أنه لا تجوز القراءة بالشاذ وأنه لا يصلى خلف من يقرأ بها قال العلماء من قرأ بالشاذ إن كان جاهلا به أو بتحريمه عرف ذلك فإن عاد إليه أو كان عالما به عزر تعزيرا بليغا إلى أن ينتهي عن ذلك ويجب على كل متمكن من الإنكار عليه ومنعه الإنكار والمنع
Section. It is permissible to recite the Quran in any of the seven readings agreed upon by the scholars.
The author here, rahimahullah, he talks about a mas'ala called reciting the Quran with the multitude narrations that have come to us. It is called al-qira'at al-mutawatira. And there's qira'ah which is called shadha, meaning it is not from the multitude narrations. And the author says,
agreed upon by the scholars, and unacceptable to read it in any other reading or in accordance with any of the anomalous narrations reported from the seven reciters.
Here the author says, وَتَجُوزُ it is permissible, قِرَاءَةُ الْقُرْآنِ to read the Qur'an, بِالْقِرَاءَةِ السَّبْعِ with the seven dialect, I mean seven قِرَاءَةِ الْمُجْمَعِ عَلَيْهَا which are unanimously agreed upon وَلَا تَجُوزُ and it is not permissible بِغَيْرِ السَّبْعِ anything other than the seven and what we say here is that this mas'ala we shouldn't agree with no way on which is that the صحيح المعمول the correct opinion is أَنَّ الْقِرَاءَاتْ عَشَرَةَ that they are ten not seven because these ten are متواترة وَهِيَ And it is the seven famous ones that are known, the seven that are very well known, which everybody knows, and the extra three, which are قِرَاءَةُ أَبِي جَعْفَرٍ الْمَدَنِي أَيَّعْقُوبَ الْحَضْرَمِي and خَلَفْ الْبَزَّارِ Those are the three extra ones which make it ten. So those ten are mutawatir. And if you go to the kitab written by Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah, He has a book called Munjid al-Muqri'in wa Murshid al-Talibin. He has. And there's a kitab written by Ibn Hajar. No, it's written by Al-Qastalani. Not Ibn Hajar. It's written by Al-Qastalani, rahimahullah. Qastalani, with ta. Al-Qastalani is called An-Nashru fi al-Qira'at al-Ashar. He expands on that as well. Subki in his kitab Jam' al-Jawami', first volume, page 44, he expands on it as well, that the sab'a are mutawatir, and also the extra three are in there as well.
In the seventh chapter, Lord willing, we will clarify what the jurists have agreed upon regarding the necessary repentance of he who recites in accordance with an anonymous reading.
So the chapter to come, the author is going to explain in there, inshallah ta'ala, that the fuqaha, the jurists, unanimously agree عَلَى اسْتِتَابَةِ مَنْ قَرَى بِالشَّوَادِ, that he is asked to repent, the one who reads the Qur'an with the shad recitation. He's going to be asked to repent from what he just did, because what he's done is incorrect. Naam.
Our companions as well as other scholars have ruled that if the reciter recites in accordance with an anonymous narration in his prayers and is completely aware that it is anonymous, his prayers will become invalid.
So if the person, he reads with the shawad in the salah, the qira'at which are not the 10, he reads the extra qira'at which are shad, they're not from those 10, okay? He reads with those recitation, the scholars from Shafi'iyah, Madhab and others, they say, batalat salatu, his salah is null and void, if he has knowledge of that. وَإِنْ كَانَ جَاهِلًا, but if he's ignorant, لَمْ تُبْطَلْ, his salah is not null and void, it's accepted. وَلَا تُحْسَبْ لَهُ تِلْكَ الْقِرَاءَ, but that recitation will not be, he will not be held for it.
Imam Abu Umar ibn Abdul Baril Hafid reports that the scholars are unanimously agreed that it is not permissible to recite in accordance with the anonymous narrations, and that it is not permissible to be led in prayer by one who does so.
So, Abu Umar ibn Abdul Bar rahimahullah, he says, Ijma'u al-Muslimin, the consensus of the Muslims are connected. It is the consensus of the Muslims, what? That it is not permissible. That it's not permissible, al-qira'at bi-shadi, to read the shadi recitations. وَأَنَّهُ لَا يُصَلَّى خَلْفَ مَنْ يَقْرَأُ بِهَا, and we don't pray behind a person who does so. We're not allowed to pray behind that person. That consensus, ijma'. مَنْ نَقَلَ الْإِجْمَعُ, who transmitted the ijma'? Ibn Abd al-Barr, and he transmitted in his kitab al-Tamheed, which is the Sharh al-Muwatta Imam Malik, the fourth volume, page 278.
The scholars have also stated that whoever is heard reciting in accordance with an anonymous reading and does not know of its prohibition or know that it is anonymous must be informed.
So man qara bi shad, anyone who reads with the recitations that are shad, if he's ignorant of it, or he's ignorant of its prohibition, urrifa dhalika, he will be informed of that. And it will be said that, you know, these are the only 10 recitations that I have reached out through multitude narration. The rest, we don't read them. They're not from the they don't fall. It's dismissed. فَإِنْ عَادَ إِلَيْهِ, if the person after being informed of that, he goes back to it, or if he's a person who already knew the ruling, عُزِّرَ تَعْزِيرًا بَلِيغًا إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْتَهِ عَنْ ذَلِكَ, he would be?
This person should be strictly and seriously disciplined until he desists.
So he's disciplined. He is what? He's disciplined. So he's until he stops what he's doing. Naam.
It is also mandatory for anyone able to prevent him from reciting in this manner to do so if possible.
And anyone who can, for example, if the masjid has authority and strong, they should stop him from re-leading the masjid. There has to be yajib ala kulli mutamakkin, everyone who has the ability. Look how we condition ability. من الإنكار عليه to what? To stop him from this. ومنعه الإنكار والمنع. نعم. To stop him from doing so. فصل في حكم الانتقال من قراءة إلى أخرى. إذا ابتدأ بقراءة أحد القراء فينبغي ألا يزال على القراءة بها ما دام الكلام مرتبطا. فإذا انقضى ارتباطه فله أن يقرأ بقراءة آخر من السبعة والأولى دوامه على الأولى في هذا المجلس.
section, it says, if the reciter begins to recite in one of the seven agreed upon readings, he should adhere to that reading for as long as the verses are tied together in meaning.
If the author, rahimahullah, he starts a particular qira'ah, فَيَنْبَغِي then it is required from him أَلَّا يَزَالَ عَلَى الْقِرَاءَةِ بِهَا He should carry on that qira'ah. مَا دَامَ الْكَلَامُ مُرْتَبِطًا Since the speech of Allah is actually connected. فَإِذَا انْقَطَ ارْتِبَاطُ Or as long as the story is some... If it's a matter which is connected, that has some relationship with one another, because some of the Qur'an, Allah shifts to something else. So if it's a portion which is connected, then you should make that one qira'ah then. And if he wants to shift away, then he should wait for a place where the speech is not kind of connected. And Allah is shifting to somewhere else. So he goes, فَإِذَا انْقَضَ ارْتِبَاطُهُ if it's not connected anymore, and it's no longer that way, فَلَهُ أَنْ يَقْرَ بِقِرَاءَةٍ آخَرَ مِنَ السَّبْعَةِ Then he can choose from the other seven. We're saying the other 10. With the other remaining 9, he can choose from whichever one he wants to read from. And then he says, وَالْأَوْلَى دَوَامُ عَلَى الْأُولَى فِي هَذَا الْمَجْلِسِ But what is better is that he stays on the first recitation that he already started with, and that he's consistent upon that. That's better for him in that particular gathering. Sorry, I took it. Yeah. Faslun fi tartib al qira'ah. قال العلماء الاختيار أن يقرأ على ترتيب المصحف فيقرأ الفاتحة ثم البقرة ثم آل عمران. ثم ما بعدها على الترتيب وسواء قرأ في الصلاة أو في غيرها حتى قال بعض أصحابنا إذا قرأ في الركعة الأولى سورة قل أعوذ برب الناس يقرأ في الثانية بعد الفاتحة من البقرة قال بعض أصحابنا ويستحب إذا قرأ سورة أن يقرأ بعدها التي تليها ودليل هذا أن ترتيب المصحف إنما جعل هكذا لحكمة فينبغي أن يحافظ عليها إلا فيما ورد الشرع باستثناء كصلاة الصبح يوم الجمعة يقرأ في الأولى سورة السجدة وفي الثانية هل أتى على الإنسان وصلاة العيد في الأولى قاف وفي الثانية اقتربت الساعة وركعتي سنة الفجر في الأولى قل يا أيها الكافرون وفي الثانية قل هو الله أحد وركعات الوتر في الأولى سبح اسم ربك الأعلى وفي الثانية قل يا أيها الكافرون وفي الثالثة قل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين ولو خالف الموالاة فقرأ سورة لا تلي الأولى أو خالف الترتيب فقرأ سورة ثم قرأ سورة قبلها جاز فقد جاءت بذلك آثار كثيرة وقد قرأ عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه في الركعة الأولى من الصبح بالكهف وفي الثانية بسورة يوسف وقد كري جماعة مخالفة ترتيب المصحف روى ابن أبي داود عن الحسن أنه كان يكره أن يقرأ القرآن إلا على تأليفه في المصحف وبإسناده الصحيح عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه أنه قيل له إن فلانا يقرأ القرآن منكوسا فقال ذلك منكوس القلب وأما قراءة سورة من آخرها إلى أولها فممنوعا منعا متأكدا فإنه يذهب بعض ضروب الإعجاز ويزيل حكمة ترتيب الآيات وقد روى ابن أبي داود عن إبراهيم النخعي الإمام التابعي الجليل والإمام مالك بن أنس أنهما كرها ذلك وأن مالكا كان يعيبه ويقول هذا عظيم وأما تعليم الصبيان من آخر المصحف إلى أوله فحسن ليس من هذا الباب فإن ذلك قراءات متفاصلة في أيام متعددة مع ما فيه من تسهيل الحفظ عليهم والله أعلم.
The scholars have stated that it is recommended that the reciter adhere to the reciting chapters in the order that they appear in the Mus'haf. Hence, a reciter beginning with Al-Fatiha should follow it with Al-Baqarah and then Ali Imran, etc. This ruling pertains to recitation both during prayers and outside of that. Some of our companions have even stated that if the reciter recites Surah An-Nas in the first rak'ah, he should then begin to recite Al-Baqarah after completing Al-Fatiha in the second rak'ah.
The author here, rahimahullah, he talks about the order of the Quran. He says, قال العلماء, the scholars, they said, الاختيار, the thing that is chosen is that the person reads the Quran in the order which the Mus'haf has put it. So for example, the person reads Surah Al-Fatiha, then he reads Baqarah, then he reads Ali Imran, then he reads what comes after it in how the order is. Okay? Whether سواء قراء في الصلاة أو في غيرها, whether it's in the prayer or outside the prayer. You see, until some of the Shafi'i scholars said, if he reads in the first rak'ah, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ سُورَةُ النَّاسِ, then the second one he should read after Fatiha, he should read Suratul Baqarah. نعم. And he said, قَالَ بَعْضُ أَصْحَابِنَا, some of the Shafi'iyya said, وَيُسْتَحَبُّ إِذَا قَرَأَ surah, that is also recommended that if a person reads a surah, أَنْ يَقْرَأَ بَعْدَهَا الَّتِي تَلِيهَا, that he reads the surah after it in order. And the dalil for that is they say that the tartib al-mus'haf, that the Quran, the surahs and the chapters were placed like this in this order. إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ هَذَا لِحِكْمَةٍ, and all of this was for wisdom. So it is upon you, فَيَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُحَافِظَ عَلَيْهَا, that the person, he basically observes the wisdom. Except what? إِلَّا فِي مَا وَرَدَ الشَّرْعُ بِاسْتِثْنَائِهِ, except whatever the Sharia has given an exception to. Such as كصلاة الصبح يوم الجمعة, like for example the Fajr of a Friday morning, Friday Fajr. Which one do you read in the beginning? Sajda. And then the second one you read what? Surah Al-Insan. The order's gone now. Look how many surahs you jumped. Also Salatul Eid, the first one what do you read? Qaf. And in the second one what do you read? Surah اقتربت الساعة وشق القمر. The rak'atay of Fajr, what do you read? The first one you read قل يا الكافرون, the sunnahs, well of course the two sunnahs before Fajr, you read what? قل يا الكافرون, and you read the second one what? قل هو الله أحد. Again, look at the distance between the two. Witr, what do you read? سبح اسم ربك الأعلى, and you read قل يا الكافرون, and in the third one you read قل هو الله أحد, and the mu'awwidhatayn, right? So this is going against the sequence and the order in which what? It is in. He says this is what? مَا وَرَدَ الشَّرْعُ اسْتِثْنَاءُ, the Sharia came and it gave an exception here.
Some among our companions have also stated that it is recommended for one finishing a chapter to begin reciting the chapter immediately after it. As proof, they mentioned that the arrangement of the chapters in the Mus'haf lies in accordance with Allah's wisdom, and that it is therefore preferable to adhere to that except in instances where there is proof that exceptions were made. Such exceptions include dawn prayers on Fridays, where it is recommended to recite Surah Al-Sajda in the first rak'ah, and then Al-Insan in the second rak'ah, and the Eid prayer, where it is recommended to recite Qaf in the first rak'ah and then Surah Al-Qamar in the second. It is also recommended that one recite Al-Kafirun and then Al-Ikhlas in the two rak'ahs preceding the dawn prayer. And among the recommended means of praying witr, it is to recite Al-A'la and Al-Kafirun in the first two rak'ahs and then Al-Ikhlas, Al-Falaq, and An-Nas in the third. There is, however, nothing wrong with not reciting the chapters in sequence, or with reciting one chapter and then a chapter preceding it, as there are various reports that their predecessors would do this.
So here he goes, وَلَوْ خَالَفَ الْمُوَالَاتِ. If the person goes against the sequence and the order, فَقَرَأَ سُورَةً لَا تَلِي الْأُولَى, and it's not in order, أَوْ خَالَفَ التَّرْتِيبِ, or even he goes against the order. Okay? So he doesn't read it in the way that the surahs are after each other. Nor does he also observe the order. He jumps back to forth, back and front. He says, for example, ثُمَّ قَرَأَ سُورَةً قَبْلَهَا. He read surah before it, then no problem. Jaza, it's permissible here. And he says there are many athar, textual evidences from the pious predecessors that permit it. وَقَدْ قَرَأَ عُمَرَ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فِي الرَّكْعَةِ الْأُولَى مِنَ الصُّبْحِ بِالْكَافِ وَفِي الثَّانِيَةِ سُورَةِ يُوسُفِ.
One such example is the report that Umar ibn al-Khattab once recited Al-Kahf in the first rak'ah and then Yusuf in the second rak'ah.
So he broke what? Khalaf al-Tartib. Umar broke the Tartib. AbdulRazak narrated this in his Musannaf. AbdulRazak narrated this in his Musannaf. And this is what? This is a prime example of what? Umar, Surah Al-Kahf and Yusuf, which one is older first? So Yusuf is first, if you start from Baqarah. Yusuf is first. But he went in Kaf and then went back with Surah Yusuf again. Naam.
Some scholars have stated that it is legislatively disliked to go against the arrangement of the Mus'haf.
Some scholars, they said, it's karaha, makruh, disliked. To what? Mughalafati tartib al-Mus'hafi. To go against the order of the Mus'haf. Naam.
Ibn Abi Dawood narrated that Al-Hassan used to dislike reciting against the arrangement of the chapters in the Mus'haf. Ibn Abu Dawood also narrated
Hassan al-Basri used to dislike it. And now كان يقرأ أن يقرأ القرآن إلا على تأليفه في المصحف. He used to like to read it in the order that it is in the Mus'haf. نعم.
Ibn Abu Dawood also narrates with an authentic chain that Ibn Mas'ud was asked regarding an individual who used to recite the Quran inversely. He replied, that is because his heart is inverted.
So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was asked a person who reading the Quran invertedly. And look what he said, فَقَالَ ذَٰلِكَ مَنْكُوسُ الْقَلْبِ. His heart is inverted.
As for reciting a given chapter inversely, it is strictly forbidden, as it nullifies the miraculous nature of the verses and the wisdom behind their individual arrangement.
So now he spoke about the surah, he's speaking about what? The ayat. The order of the ayat, that's different. That's another story now. The ayat, he said, فَمَمْنُوعٌ مُؤْمَنْعًا مُتَأَكِدًا. Oh, this is severe. This one with the ayat and the order of the ayat, you can't change it. You can't change it. You can't do it back to front. The reason is because he said, فَإِنَّوْ يُذْهِبُ بَعْضَ ضُرُوبِ الْإِعْجَازِ. It gets rid of some of the miraculous. It gets rid of some of the miraculous signs and amazements that are in the Qur'an. Yeah.
Ibn Abi Dawood narrates that the Imam and prominent Tabi'i Ibrahim al-Nakhai'i and Imam Malik disliked that the verses in a chapter be read in an order opposite to their arrangement. Indeed, Malik would shun this deed and say that it is an abomination, meaning a great and grievous sin.
So here, kariha means the surah haram. Kariha here doesn't mean makruh. It means haram, haram, haram. Aya?
There is nothing wrong, however, with teaching children by going from the last chapter of the Mus'haf and then backwards towards the beginning, as this does not fall under the subject at hand.
So we Somalis, we start from Juz'amma and we make our way up. That's back to front. Is that permissible? He says that's permissible. Because we're not following the order of the Qur'an now, we're changing it. So, أَمَّا تَعْلِيمُ الصِّبْيَانِ, teaching the children, by saying we're going to start from what? Huh? From Juz'amma, for Surah An-Nas, then up like that. This, he said, فَحَسَنٌ, it's good, no problem. لَيْسَ مِنْ هَذَا الْبَابِ, this is not from this issue we're talking about right now. This has not got to do anything with what we're talking about.
Rather, this would entail different recitations done on different days.
Because this is different days. The person is going to learn just Amma today, and then tomorrow is he going to learn. So today he's going to learn Surah Al-Nas, tomorrow he's going to learn Surah Al-Falaq. It's a different day then.
And would allow students to better memorize by reading them from shorter chapters to longer ones in Allah's message.
And it's also better for the student to start. Imagine if the child straight away starts Baqarah. What? How long is this? But he starts from Juz Amma, right? And then every surah. Because Juz Amma is the juz that has the most surahs. You know that, right? How many surahs does it have? 37. Yeah? It has 37 surahs in there. Juz Amma has 37 surah. He has the most surah. That's the surah that has the most juz. Are you with me, brothers? Yes, it's the juz that has the most surahs in it. It's the juz that has the most surahs in it. It's got 37 surahs. 37 surahs. And there's the most ayahs in the Quran in one juz is in Surah 2. Juz Amma. The most ayat are in there. Does that make sense? So the student, he's learning fast. Verses are very small, short. He's learning quickly. So his brain is being trained. And he comes to just Amma, Tabarak, and it's getting a bit bigger. Okay, okay. Qad Sami' Allah comes. Ooh, it's getting even bigger now. It's tricky. Dariyat comes. Ooh. Surah Al-Ahqaf. Then Ahqaf comes. Five juzes complete. There, he's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Stop now. He's seen big verses now. But he's ready for it because he's being trained. So this is good. It's good. This is good. We'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala, for today. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.